Alright, so now the new chapter that we have over here, that is our session 8, job batch and process costing. So in this chapter, basically we will be discussing about three very basic costing techniques, the costing techniques that we need, why there is a need for a costing technique to be in place. Why do we need a costing technique? Why are you studying this chapter, or why are you studying this course of management accounting or cost accounting? Okay, so basic reason is to cost the products, to be able to identify the cost of the products and how to formulate different costs of the product. So over here in this chapter we have three different techniques which will be used in three different scenarios. Okay, so we will be using these three different techniques, that is the job costing, batch costing and process costing. All of these three techniques will be used differently in different scenarios, and where they will be used, that I will be telling you guys. Now, basic reason for having costing techniques is to cost a product, and the nature of the products will be different from one and the other. So that is why we have different techniques. We also have, apart from this one, job, batch and process, we also have one costing technique, that is service costing, which is usually used by the service industries, but that is not in the detail in your course. So we'll start with job costing. Basically what happens in a job costing, whenever we cost a product, the job costing tells you, or it indicates you over here, that what the cost of any particular job is. So over here we might be making products, we might be doing some particular job, but that will only be one job, and we will be calculating the cost of the total job as one complete job. Now job can be either be big, job can either be small. Let's suppose building is a big job. Let's say it maybe takes 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, or even 6 months or an year to complete, or it can be a very small job, just to make, you just call the relevant person. For example, you call a carpenter and to make the shelves in your room, that will hardly take half of the day. So job can be large, job can be small, but in job, as you say, a job is a one complete cost unit. One job will be considered as one complete cost unit, and whatever cost will be incurred in that particular job, we will be adding that cost into the cost of the job. Is everyone clear with that? Now it says over here, job is a cost unit that I have told you, which consists of a single order or a contract. Now that order can be small, that order can be big, depending on the nature of the order. Job costing is a costing method used where each cost unit is separately identifiable. Separately identifiable. This is very distinguishing feature of job costing, that every unit will be separately identified. Now if you're working as a contractor and you have contracts of making buildings, so the building A that you are building will be different from building B, will be different from building C, and for each of the building you will be having separate contracts and separate particular price according to which you will be determining the cost of each of the particular job. And that is what we need to do over here. In job costing, the total cost of every job will be identified. How much material is being input in there, how much labor is being input in there, how much overheads are being input in there, what are the fixed costs, what are the variable costs, everything will be included into the cost of the job. Okay, and one very important feature over here is that the job that we will take will be according to the requirements of the customer. How? very simple. Now, again, continuing with the same example that we have, you are a contractor of the building, and the building A that has been given to you as a contract, will that be exactly the same to the building B which has been given to you by some different person? Obviously not. So the job that will be carried out will be depending on the requirements of the customer, right? Now, if I am working as a carpenter, someone might call me to make shelves within the house, someone might call me to make some cupboard or whatsoever, right? So the job that will be given to me by a customer will be according to the needs of the customer, according to the tailor-made requirements of the customer, right? And obviously we will be having different processes during which the jobs will go, but ultimately you have to identify the total cost of any of the particular job, right? Now, what relevant cost do we have in the job? Obviously the material cost, how much material is being inputted. So how will you identify the material? Either invoices will be there for the special material that you will buy in for that particular job, that okay, I need this much particular amount of this material X or material Y, especially dedicated for this particular job. So from that invoices you can identify the amount of material and the price of the material. Or if you are taking the material from your warehouse, if you will be taking the material from your warehouse, that material will be labeled with the code of the job, that this much material is going to job ABC, this much material is going to job XYZ. It will be labeled with the code of the particular job. Similar case happens with the labor, that how much labor is going into the job. So we will be having time sheets, that how much time a particular labor is spending on job ABC, on job XYZ, whereas the other expenses or the overheads will be, if they are specific, they will be allocated. If they are general overheads, they will be apportioned by the help of what? How do we charge overheads to the particular cost units? How do we charge overheads? With the help of what? What was the main aim when we were doing the big question on overheads? What were we trying to identify? Overhead absorption rate. Overhead absorption rate, OAR. We will charge the cost to that particular cost unit or job with the help of overhead absorption rate. Getting my point? It's written over here. If indirect, then expenses are often charged to job on the basis of time and overhead absorption rate. Okay, there's not much detail. If I tell you in a layman term, how will you solve the questions of job costing? It's like this. You will simply have to identify how many costs are being incurred in that particular job, simply add them. And in the end, if you have some profit, because there might be some questions in which you have to identify the selling price. So selling price will be identified by applying the percentage of profit. So you will add the percentage of profit and then identify the selling price. Have I done with you guys the concept of markup and margin? No? Okay, then we will be discussing that. Alright, so we have an example over here. Job 666 required 20 kgs of material in stores, which cost $15 per kg. So that's about the material. And also special component that had to be bought at a cost of $150. So two kinds of material you have that is being inputted into the material into the job. That is a normal material of 20 kgs and one special component of $150. 30 hours labor were spent on the job, where the employees were paid at 9 per hour. In addition, 3 hours were spent by the supervisor, who is paid 15 per hour. overhead are absorbed at a rate of $4 per labor hour. What is the basis of overhead? What is the basis of overheads? Labor hour. You will always identify the basis of overheads by looking at the overhead absorption rate. Overhead absorption rate. Some, if it is given $4 per labor hour, so your basis will be labor hour. If it is given $4 per machine hour, so your basis to absorb the overheads will be machine hour. If it is given $4 per unit, so your basis will be to absorb the overheads on the units. If it is machine hours, so your basis will be machine hours. If it is labor hours, your basis will be labor hours. If it is number of units, it will be number of units. If it is kgs or whatever the term that is attached to overhead absorption rate will be your basis of overhead absorption into the product. So tell me guys, how many total labor hours are being worked? 30 hours are being worked by the normal employee, normal labor, and 3 hours are worked by the supervisor. So how many total labor hours are there? 33. So when you will be absorbing overheads into the product, you will multiply this 4 by 30, by 3, or by 33? By 33, definitely. So calculate the total cost of the job. Now if you look at the answer, it says 20 kgs at 15 per kg, so the total cost is 300, and then one special component at a price of 150. So the chapter of material is closed over here. Then we have labor, 30 normal labor at a rate of 9, so total cost 270. Then 3 hours of supervisor who is paid 15 per hour, so the total cost 45. And then we have overheads, the total labor hours are 33 and the rate of overhead is 4, overhead absorption rate. So that will be 33 into 4, 132. So that is known as your total cost of the job. Total cost of the job. Now guys, one important concept I want to discuss with you guys, and that is the concept of markup and margin. Two different things are these. Both of them are the percentages of profit, but there's a slight difference between them. There are two percentages which we apply. One is known as markup, the other one is known as margin. In normal business, most of the times they are used interchangeably, that markup and margin are the same thing. But there's a very fine line between markup and margin, a very fine line. Markup, definitely a percentage of profit, but it is applied on cost. Markup is applied on cost. In this case, cost will be 100%. In this case, cost will be 100%. Whereas margin is applied on sales figure. So in this case, sales would be 100%. So what, guys, just tell me this, what is the normal equation that we make? Is it something like this? Sales minus cost is equals to profit. I'm talking about just the normal figure, a common man, layman figure. So sales minus cost gives you profit. If it is markup, if it is markup, which one will I keep 100%, sales or cost? Cost. Why? Because markup is applied on cost. So my cost would be 100%. Just for example, I'm saying, let's suppose the profit percentage is 20%. Just for example, it can be anything. It can be 20, 25, 30, anything. So just for example, let's suppose my profit figure is 20%. How much my sales figure will now represent? Sales minus cost gives you profit. 120%. This is how you identify the percentages. If it is markup, which one will you keep 100%? Cost. If it is markup, you will keep cost as 100%. The profit percentage will be given to you, and according to that, you will easily identify the percentage of sales. If it is margin, so which one will I keep 100%? Margin is applied on sales, so sales will be 100%. Let's suppose my profit is 20% again. So how much my cost will now be?
80.
It will be 80%. Okay. Now guys, please be very careful in the exam. Let's suppose a similar kind of question which we just did right now is given to you in the exam. And in the exam situation, they are saying that it is a margin of 20% applied on cost. What will you do then? It is a margin of 20% applied on cost. What will you consider it as? Markup or margin?
Markup.
No matter, they try to play with the words, because markup and margin, if you talk about the English language, both means the same thing. But whatever it is applied on, that is what is important. If it is applied on cost, so you will be considering it as markup, because markup is always applied on cost. Margin is always applied on sales. So if they say 20% profit margin applied on sales, it will be your margin figure. If they say 20% profit figure applied on your, or they can say 20% profit margin applied on cost, so it will be your markup. So be very careful about this. Now, how to identify any profit figure? Now, what was the cost we were having in the previous question? The total cost of the product?
897.
It means the cost figure is 897. This is what we calculated, right? Now, just do one thing. What we need to do is this, that 897 is your cost. By, with the help of markup, tell me the profit figure and the sales figure. With the help of markup, not margin. Margin I will do. Your cost is representing how much? 100%. Percent, I'm asking about the percentage. How much percentage it is representing? 100%. So I told you guys, whatever percentage is represented by the figure, you will divide that figure by its percentage. And if I am asking profit, so you will multiply it by that percentage. So how will you do it? If you want to identify the profit figure with the help of markup, it will be profit is equals to 897 divided by 100% multiply. Where do we want to go? 20 or 120? We want to identify the profit figure only. So 20%. So this is how you will do. Whatever percentage that is represented by the figure, You will divide that figure by its percentage, and whatever figure or percentage you want to go at, you will multiply that percentage. Okay? So similarly, identify the sales figure. First of all, tell me what will be the profit figure.
179.4.
So this is your profit figure, right? So what will be the sales figure? Again, 897 divide by 100 multiply by 120. Now, if profit figure is given to you, this profit figure is given to you, and I am asking you to calculate the cost figure for me. Suppose cost figure is not given to you. Can you identify the cost figure? How? 179.4. How much percentage it is representing? 20. So divide by 20, and where do we want to go? 100. Multiply by 100. 897. Even if you want to go to sales, 179.4 divide by 20. Multiply by 120. 1076.4. So whatever amount is there, divide it by the percentage it is representing, and wherever you want to go, multiply by that percentage. Easy? 20? This one?
Yeah,
no problem. That will just be change of figure. If this would have been 30%, your cost will remain same because this is markup. Cost will be 100%. So now your sales will be 130%. If it is margin, your sales will remain same, but this is now 30%. So your cost will be 70%. That will be according to the question that you have to adjust. That is what I am saying, that you have to identify according to the question that what you have to do. But the equation and the concept will remain same. If it is a markup, cost will remain 100%. If it is a margin, sales will remain 100%. Is everyone clear on that? Okay. Now, again, do this for margin. Guys, quickly, same concept will apply. You have the cost, 897. Tell me the profit figure and the sales figure quickly. In case of margin, how much amount of cost is representing the percentage? This 897 is representing how much percentage? 80. So divide by 80. Where do we want to go? Let's suppose calculate sales first. So multiply by 100. It will give 1121.25. Everyone is getting? Now you want to identify the profit. So 897 divide by 80 multiply by 20. 224.25. And you can easily verify your answer by subtracting sales from cost. Again, you will get the same figure, obviously, because that will be the figure of the profit. So you can reconcile your answer easily. Is everyone clear on this? Any confusion? Okay, good. Now, everyone has copied this?
Yes.
Okay. Now, moving on further, this is the job account. Job account. If you guys remember what we discussed in the chapter of material, whatever will be coming in any of the section, that will be debited, and whatever is going from that particular area, that will be credited. So if material is coming into raw material, Raw material will be debited, payables or cash will be credited. If raw material is now moving towards work in progress, so work in progress will be debited and raw material will be credited. Over here, same is the case. Whatever things we will be inputting into the job, whether we are inputting material, whether we are inputting labor, whether we are inputting any particular expense or any overhead, everything will be debited. And in the end, when the job will be finished, that will be credited. Everyone clear? That whatever we will be inputting into the job, that will be debited. The job will be debited by that particular amount, whether it's material, labor or overheads. And when the job will be finished, we will simply credit the account and balance the account by the reference of finished good or finished job. Clear? All right. That was it from the job costing. Now the next thing that we have to talk about is the batch costing. Guys, to be very straightforward to you, everything is same in batch costing. Everything else is same apart from one concept. And that concept is that instead of having one identifiable unit, in batch costing we will be having identical similar units. So let's suppose a pack of biscuit, you have 10 or 12 biscuits with the identical nature. Cotton buds, you have a few cotton buds in the pack with the same identical nature. Toothpicks, you have same identical nature. So some of the products are there which cannot be sold in single piece, so we have to sell them in batches, or they are prepared in batches. So when things are prepared in batches, when the things are prepared in batches, we have to cost them also in a batch. So everything else over here will remain same apart from one different concept, identifiable. And because of that, one additional calculation we will be having, and that is in job costing, that 897 that we reached was the cost of one job. Okay, that was the cost of one job. In batch costing, what will usually happen is that we will be reaching one cost at the end after adding material, labor, everything. We will just add it, we will reach one cost, and that cost will be of whole batch. Let's say 20 units, 30 units, 40 units. That cost will be of every unit in the batch, total unit. In the exam, you have to be very careful about one thing, because examiner might ask you, because what usually I have identified in the students in the past 1 to 2 years is that they just rush into the question. They don't read the question completely. If they say, okay, what's the cost of the batch? Rushing into the question. Don't do this. Examiner is very smart, so he can trick you very easily. Let's suppose you are being asked about the cost of total batch, you calculated cost per unit of the batch. You are being asked about the cost per unit of the batch, you calculated only the cost of total batch. So you have to be very careful, because there are two things that we will be calculating from this calculation of batch costing, and that is that when you will be calculating the total cost, that total cost, let's suppose the same thing, 897 is the cost of all the units in the batch, 100 units, let's suppose. Now if I ask you what is the cost of one unit in the batch, so what you will do, 897 divided by 100, so 8.97 will be the cost of one unit. But we will identify the cost of the whole batch first and then calculate cost per unit. So that is what we have over here. We'll just go through the theory quickly. A batch is a cost unit which consists of separate readily identifiable group of product units which maintain their separate identity throughout the production process. So they might be identical in nature, They might be grouped in one batch, but they will be having separate existence, right? Batch costing is similar to job costing in that each batch of similar article is separately identified. So we will be making one batch. Cost per unit, total batch cost divided by the number of units in one batch. So that's very common sense. Again, one example we have, because example is the best way through which you can understand things. Batch 7777 used 2000 kgs of material in store, which cost 10 per kg, and also 500 kg of special material that was bought in at $4 per kg. So this was the story of material. 90 labor hours were spent in department A, where the employee are paid 12 per hour. 40 hours are spent in department B, where employees are paid 10 per hour. Overheads are absorbed at rate of $3 per labor hour. So what is your basis of overhead absorption?
Labor hour.
900 units were produced in one batch. So how many units are being produced in one batch?
900.
So first of all, what we will do? We will identify the cost of one unit, or we will identify the cost of all total 900 units? Total 900 units. So first of all, we will identify the cost of total 900 units. Material from the stores, how many kgs were there? 2000. What's the price?
10.
So the total cost? 20,000. Special material, 500 kgs. What was the price?
4.
So the total? 2000. Labor in department A, how many hours?
90.
What was the rate?
12.
So total cost 1080. Then labor in department B, 40 hours. What was the rate?
10.
400 total. And then overheads, how many hours do we have in total?
130.
90 in A, 40 in B. So total 130 into the OAR 3. Total cost 390. So the total cost is 23870. But this 23870 is the cost of how many units? 1 or 900?
900.
If the examiner asks you, tell me the total cost of one batch, where will you stop? This point, or you will go further? You will stop over here, because this is the cost of total batch. If the examiner asks you, tell me cost per unit, so then you will do the next step, and that is 23870 divided by 900. So the cost of one unit will be 26.52. If the examiner is asking you, tell me the cost of whole batch only, so you will stop at 23870. But if the examiner is asking you, tell me the cost of one unit, that is cost per unit, so you will do the next step, that is 23870 divided by 900. Easy?
Yes.
Great. Now, a little bit of difference between job costing and batch costing. Now, when we are controlling the cost in job costing, the things are a bit difficult. Why? The first thing is that every job is different from each other. Let's suppose the company who is making Burj Khalifa, and they are making a single family house, the material required in Burj Khalifa will be equal to the house? Obviously not, isn't it? So the requirement of material, the requirement of the labor force, the requirement of the further expenses will be different in each job. Similarly, a carpenter who is making a cupboard, will the same kind of or same amount will be required in order to make shelves? No, obviously different set of different, that the job is of different nature. The amount required by the labor, the material required in the job will be different. Similarly, a person working in a garage, one person is coming just for the service of the car, the other one is coming for the repairing of an engine. Obviously, two different jobs are there. So each time, different material, different labor, different timing will be required. So that is the major drawback in job cost, that every time, whenever we need to control cost, how can we control cost? That is when we need one standard time, one standard requirement of the material, standard requirement of the labor. Then we can control that, okay, this is the standard. According to the standard, you have gone above or gone below. That is when we compare with the standard. But over here, we don't have any standard, because every job is of a different nature, and because of which different requirement of material and labor would be there in every job. And that is what we have here. Why it will be difficult to estimate the material required, how much time might be required by the job, and how much overheads will be incurred for the particular job. Whereas coming to the batch costing, in batch costing, we will be having similar products, identical products, and each batch will be of, let's say, because when you are making the products in batches, a pack of, let's say, biscuits, if one pack is having 9 biscuits, the other one will also have 9 biscuits. So in that, it will be easier for you to control the cost, because as they say, batch costing produce similar products in a batch. So it will be easier to control cost, as units are identical, unlike job costing. Because in job costing, every job is different nature, whereas in service batch costing, batches have same amount of products and same identical products. And in batch costing, there will be one cost which will be known as the setup cost, which will be incurred when the production of the batch will be started. So that if your batch size is small, so the setup cost will be high, because you need to set up the cost, set up the production again and again, again and again. But if your production batch is of good amount of quantity of units, so the setup cost will be low, because you will be setting up it once and then producing a good amount of units. But if you are producing only 10 units in one batch, so you have to keep setting up the batch again and again. So it can be controlled by working quickly and making products in suitable sizes. It should not be that too much big, not too much small, a suitable and the optimal size. Large batches result in fewer batches, therefore lower setup cost. Because if you will be producing large batches, so the number of batches will reduce, because you will be accommodating more amount of units in one batch. And when your accommodation will increase in one batch, the setup cost will also come down. Okay? Process costing. A very important area of this chapter. Process costing. A very important area of this chapter. Now, in process costing, it's a very different kind of a thing. Very different. In job, you make a product, provide it to the customer, finish. In batch, you make a batch, provide it to the customer, finish. In service costing, you provide service to the customer, finish. In process, the production of any of the particular unit will be a continuous process. It will be going through different processes. Cycle, definitely. So when we talk about process costing, the very common example is that we have over here, oil refining. What do you make oil from? What is the raw material for preparing oil products? The crude oil, right? You make kerosene, petrol, diesel, any other petroleum products with the help of crude oil, which is extracted from the earth. So crude oil goes through different processes. In one process, you are getting kerosene. In another process, you are getting petrol. In another process, you are getting diesel. In another process, you are getting some other product. Other example, milk products, dairy products. What's the main source of producing dairy products? Milk. From milk, you're making yogurt. From milk, you're making some drinks. From milk, again, you're making butter. From milk, you are making cheese. So one product results in different products with the help of the continuous processes. And when it goes from different processes, different products are being produced. So that is where we need to talk in the terms of process costing. And the process costing will be talking about the cost of one period. No matter how many processes are there, we'll just talk about one period. That in this particular period, what was the particular cost of the process? It's a bit difficult process. And little bit technical, not that too much technical, but you just need to identify the some things related to the T accounts. But it's easy. Now, what does it say over here? Examples we have discussed. Because work carries on continuously, there are no batches. The work is just continuously going on through processes. No batches are there. As creating batch implies that you know when it start and stop, and therefore what cost have gone into that. But you don't know in process, because process is continuously running. So we will identify the starting point, we will identify the ending point, but we don't know when the process starts, when the process ends. So over here, this is a continuous running and the production of the goods. In process costing, costs are worked on periods. Measure the costs that are used in a period and the output produced in the period, and you have a way of working out the cost per unit. And what will be that way? Definitely I will be discussing with you guys. Process costs are attributed to the unit produced in the period. Okay. Now, there are certain features of process costing which are very common, which can be there in job costing and batch costing as well, but to process costing, this is very common. Very common. The first thing is loss. Whatever material you would be inputting, let's suppose you are inputting 100 liters of crude oil into some process to make petrol. Will you be getting 100 liters of petrol? No. Some might be lost, some might be evaporated. So let's say you get 90 liters of petrol. Similarly, when you are producing milk products, dairy products, if you are producing butter, so does that mean that 100 liters of milk will be converted into 100 kgs of butter? No, again there will be some spoilage, there will be some wastage. Let's suppose because of obsolescence, the milk got wasted, because you know that milk is a perishable nature. It gets rotten very quickly. Similarly, let's suppose you are working in a chemical manufacturing company. So again, in chemical manufacturing company, some of the chemicals, or you are trying to produce something, and because of that, some chemicals might get evaporated, spilled, wasted, right? So in this case, loss is a very common feature in process costing. Output of one process becomes the input of the next process, because it is a continuous process. So process one ends, process two starts. Process two ends, process three starts. So the output of one process becomes the input of the other process. So let's say from crude oil you get some filtered oil, and that filtered oil goes into the further processing, which turns into petrol or kerosene or whatsoever products you have. And there's one also very common feature of process costing: joint products, single products, and byproducts. Sometimes from one process you will only get one product, that is known as the single product. Sometimes from one process you can get two different products. Very common thing that you just input crude oil into the process and you get two different products, petrol and diesel, right? And byproducts are there as well. Byproducts, look, there's a difference between joint products and byproducts, a very huge difference. Joint products are the products, two different products are being produced from the same process and both have equal value, equal importance. Whereas byproduct is a product which has been produced as a result of, by chance it has been produced, and its value is very insignificant. very small. So we don't consider it as an important product. So let's suppose you have bought an asset worth $1,000. You have used it for $950, like for the period of time it has been depreciated, and only $50 is remaining, which you will be getting as a scrap value. So scrap value or the residual value, very small value, trivial amount. We don't consider it as a very income or something like that. So we just reduce it from the cost of the asset and then depreciate the asset over the useful life. The same is the case over here. You guys will not be examined on joint products and byproducts over here. We will be talking about very simple process costing over here. So the key steps in process costing that we will have, first of all, we will be determining the output and losses, that how much we have input into the product, input into the process, how much is the expected output. So let's say my input is 100 kgs and I'm expecting 10% is my normal loss. So how much will my expected output will be? 90 units or 90 kgs. So this is how we identify the output and losses. Then you calculate cost per unit of the output. How do we calculate cost per unit? In normal situations, what's the formula to calculate cost per unit? Total cost divided by total number of units. Simple. In process costing, it's a bit different. In process costing, what you will do is total cost of input divided by expected number of units. Expected. We will always take expected number of units over here. Expected. Never ever we will take total units or input units. Always expected number of units. Expected. And then we calculate the cost of the output and the work in progress. So this is what we have over here. Now, as we were discussing, that normal losses are a very common feature of process costing. So almost all of the processes will be incurring loss, and that loss will be removed from the calculation of cost per unit, because that will not be giving us any benefit. Now, what we will usually do with that loss is that, let's suppose you are a tire manufacturer. So you know that tires are manufactured with the help of rubber, right? So when we manufacture tires, so some rubber might be wasted. Whatever you have input, let's say 1000 kgs, so 100 kgs is wasted. Now that 100 kg is with you, and some scrap dealer is coming to you and saying that I can buy that 100 kg for some reduced price or something like that. So what you will do? You will keep it or sell it? Definitely you will sell it, because you will say, for me it is anyway scrap, I will never be able to use it. So that normal loss that you have, what are you gonna do? You're gonna sell it. So you will be recording its total cost on the amount that you have sold, or the amount of cost per unit that you have calculated. On the amount that you have sold it for. Because you are selling it for some cost, and if you are recording it at this cost per unit, wouldn't it be unfair? Wouldn't it be unfair? So we have to record the cost of normal loss at scrap value. If we don't have a scrap value, then the value of normal loss will be zero. We will never take normal loss on the cost per unit. Never ever your normal loss will be on cost per unit. Now with losses, I have one question with you guys. 1000 units I have inputted into the process, 1000 kgs, okay? I'm expecting my normal loss is usually 10%. So So how much is my expected output?
900.
Okay, 900 is my expected output. Now instead of 900, I am getting 850 as actual output. 50 extra loss. What will that be known as? Extra loss? Definitely, because I have made extra loss. In the terms of process costing, that loss of 50 will be known as abnormal loss. That loss of extra 50 would be known as abnormal loss. Because were you expecting that loss? No. So that is an abnormality in the process. Second thing, I was expecting 900 units. I got 950. So that extra 50 that I have made will be known as abnormal gain. So if you produce more than your expected units, the extra units will be known as abnormal gain. If you produce less than your expected units, it will be known as the abnormal loss. Right? And one very important thing, abnormal loss and abnormal gain will always be charged on cost per unit. Normal loss will be going on scrap, but abnormal loss and abnormal gain will always be charged on cost per unit because we never expected that. Okay, now we have one example over here, illustration. 1000 kgs at $3.6 per kg were input into the process. When things are being input into the process, the account will be debited or credited?
Debited,
definitely. So, guys, your process account will be something like this. I'm just making a pro forma kind of a thing for you guys. Right? So, input. In input, we can have material. We can have labor. We can have overheads. Now, when this will be converted into finished goods, debited or credited?
Credited.
It will be credited with the term output. Now, in this output, there might be some normal loss as well. When I'm making loss of input, is that coming into the process or going out of the process? When I'm making a loss of the input, I'm losing the input. Definitely, it's going out of the process. So obviously we can have normal loss. If I'm making more loss than expected, abnormal loss will be there. Debited or credited?
Credited.
Abnormal loss, because you're making some extra loss. Right? If I'm making gain, abnormal gain, so that will be debited because that will be increasing my process in units. And this will be balancing your account. This will be balancing your T account. Now, when we are balancing the T account, this output, for input you will be given cost, that material 10,000 kgs at this amount per kg, labor this much hours at this rate per hour, overheads with this absorption rate at this basis. So input will be easy to put into the T account. But output, normal loss, abnormal loss, abnormal gain. These are the four things that you need to be very careful. Output, whatever number of units will be there, it will be going on cost per unit that we will be calculating. Abnormal loss, units into cost per unit. Abnormal gain, units into cost per unit. What about normal loss? Units into scrap value.
So how do we identify the scrap value?
It will be given in the question. That you can sell the normal loss at 2 per kg or 3 per kg or whatever will be given, it will be given to you within the question. Right? Just copy this down quickly so that we can move on towards the illustration. Okay? I hope everything is clear to you guys up till now. Great. Right, everyone has copied. Okay, now let's just move on to the illustration. 1000 kgs at $3.6 per kg were input to a process and there was 10% loss due to evaporation. So if you are inputting 1000 kgs, 10% loss, what is this?
Normal
loss. 900 goods should result and their cost per unit will be, how do you identify the cost per unit? How do you identify the cost per unit? Total input cost. How many things do we have in this question in the input? Only material. Only material is there.
So
1000 into 3.6. So 3600. What are the expected number of units? 900. So 3600 divided by 900 gives you
4.
So when you will be pricing the output, this output will go on 4 per unit. Okay, next illustration we have. 1000 kgs at 4 per kg were input to a process and there was 20% loss due to filtration. Material is filtered out, could be sold for 0.5. This time you would be able to sell the normal loss. In the previous question, were you able to sell the normal loss? No, they only identified that there is a normal loss, but they didn't give any scrap value, so we will consider the value 0. But over here, what they are saying, material could be sold for 0.5 per kg. if the good unit can't be made without making some losses, it is reasonably to say that the initial cost will always be reduced by the scrap or lost units that could be sold for. Now, how much is my input? How much is my input?
1000.
1000 kgs at a price of 4. So total cost of input is 4000. How much is the expected number of units?
800.
So any difficulty in this part of the question? 1000 into 4 and 800. But if you see over here, this 200 into 0.5. This 200 into 0.5. We are able to sell our scrap units or not?
We are able
to sell our scrap units. So when you will be selling your scrap units, will that be income to you or not?
Income.
Definitely that will be an income to you. So when we will be calculating cost per unit, so from that cost, shall we not remove our income or?
Yeah,
income should be removed. Because what we are calculating? Cost per unit. This total 4000 includes the scrap value of 200 units that would be sold. So when they will be sold, some income would be coming to the company. So we will be calculating the net figure, total cost minus the income from selling of scrap units, and then we will be calculating our cost per unit. Is everyone clear with that? Is everyone clear with that? Okay. So our cost per unit this time will be, now how much is our total cost?
The cost is
4,000.
4,000.
Okay. And how much is the income?
100.
So the net cost, okay.
3,900.
So 3,900 divided by 800 will give you 4.875. And this is how we will make the process account. Now, guys, please be very focused over here. Everyone, when we input, what are we inputting?
Material.
Material. How many units?
4,000.
At a price of?
4.
So total cost?
4,000.
So this side of the T account will be totaling to? 4,000. Debit side, total 4,000. Now, how many good units we are making? 800. What is the cost per unit we have calculated?
4.875.
Multiply 800 by 4.875. 3,900. Is our T account balance?
No.
No. Why? We have not included normal loss yet. So 200 into 0.5, because we are selling the normal loss at a price of 0.5. 100. So 3,900 plus 100. Okay, this is wrong. We'll give you 4,000. Is everyone clear? This is how you will balance your T account of process. Guys, I will tell you, if you mastered in making this account, every question of process costing will be solved like this. It's just how you understand and how you get grip on the T account of process. If you are good at making the account of process, believe me, it will be very easy for you to solve any question of process account. You just need to learn, and even you don't need to memorize the thing. It's very easy and it's very basic, it's very logical. If anything is coming to the process, definitely that will be debited. So input is coming, input can be material, labor, overheads. Anything is going out of the process will be credited. What will go out? Output will go out, losses will go out, abnormal loss and normal loss. If something is increasing in the account, abnormal gain, so that will be debited. This is your total process account.
Sir, if there will be abnormal gain in this question, the risk will be right or it will be on the same?
Everything will be on the same side in its position. We just need to add abnormal gain on the debit side.
Okay. Abnormal loss on the credit
and gain. In one question, you cannot have abnormal loss and abnormal gain in the same question. Because if you are expecting 900, you can either make 950, either make 850. So in one question, you will either be having abnormal loss or abnormal gain. You cannot have both the things at the same time. Okay? Now, one last concept that we need to discuss is the concept of closing work in progress. Some processes are incomplete when we close them off. So we need to calculate the closing work in progress. In process, if the units are complete up to certain limit, so let's say 100 units are there, and each unit is, let's suppose, 30% complete. So we will assume that, we will not say that each unit is 30% complete. We will say out of 100, 30 units are complete. Getting my point? That when we will be calculating the closing work in progress, we will not be saying that every unit is 30% complete. We will be saying that out of 100, 30 units are complete. And when units are complete, do we include them in our calculation of cost per unit or not? When units are complete, we definitely include them into the calculation of cost per unit. So that is the concept of equivalent units. When we are assuming that we are not considering that every unit is 30% complete, we are assuming that out of 100, 30 units are complete. So that 30 that we are taking into the calculation of cost per unit are known as the equivalent units. And how we will do that, just stick to your concepts of process costing that we have discussed so far. Don't just deviate yourself from that. Then you will easily understand that. First thing that we need to do is the preparation of the statement of equivalent account. That how many equivalent units are there. Then we need to identify the total cost and then calculate the cost per unit based on that particular equivalent units. I know in wording is it difficult to understand, so we look at the example over here. It says that concept of equivalent says, for example, 100 units are 60% complete. So how will you identify equivalent units? 100 into 60%. So what will you say? 60 units are completely produced. In actual, it will not be like this, because every unit will be 60% complete. Out of 100, 60 are not complete. Every unit is 60% complete. But why we are doing this? If we do not do this, the cost that have been incurred in manufacturing the goods up till 60% will be ignored. And when the cost will be ignored, we will not be able to identify the correct cost of that particular process. That is why there is a need to calculate the equivalent units, and by those equivalent units, by including them into the cost per unit, we will be able to identify the correct cost of the process, right? So for example, in a month, resources enough for 1100 units and amounting to 12,360 have been used in production and have resulted in 1000 completed units. 1000 units are complete, fully 100%, plus 100 units are remaining, and each of them is 30% complete. So when we will be calculating the cost per unit, what we are going to do? 100 units wholly complete and 30 equivalent units. So the total units are 1030. So when we will be calculating the cost per unit over here, it will be how much? 12,360. That is your total cost of input. Same thing. We are doing the same thing. How to calculate the cost per unit in process? Cost of total input divided by expected number of units. Over here, 1000 are complete and 30 are we are considering to be complete, because each of them is 30% complete. So the total cost per unit will be 12,360 divided by 1030 is equals to 12. So cost per unit will be 12. Okay, cost per unit will be 12. Okay, so now again, how do we make the T account for this one? So how much we have inputted? 1100, and the total cost of input was 12,360. So the T account units 1100, cost 12,360. How much finished goods we have produced? 1000 units at the price was 12. Okay, and how many are remaining? 100 units at a price of 12, but how much they are complete? 30. So it will be 100 into 12 into 30%, because they are complete up till 30%. So the total cost will be 360. So 12,000 plus 360, accounts are balanced, closed. Okay, now let's just move on to the second example of equivalent units. It's just an example. So the first example, the first step to calculate the equivalent unit was to make the statement of equivalent units. So we have two things: material, labor and overheads, and total units. Three things are there. Guys, production cost apart from material is known as the conversion cost, because they are used to convert the product into the final good. Okay, so labor and overheads are also known as the conversion cost. Labor and overheads are also known as the conversion cost. So how many input units we have over here? 4,000. And they are saying that completed, 100% complete are how much? 3,200. So how much are remaining? 800. Okay, 800 are remaining. Now they are saying this 800 is 100% complete in respect of material, but how much? 60% complete in respect of labor and overheads. So for material total units 4,000, for 4,000, but over here we will not have 4,000, we will have 3,680, because this 800 into 60 gives you 480, because in respect of conversion the units are only 60% complete. Now the cost of material was 6,000, the cost of labor was 4,416. Just assume that it's given in the question that the cost of labor is 4,416 and the cost of material is 6,000. So in order to calculate the cost per unit, for material we will divide the 6,000 by 4,000, because for material the total units are 4,000, but for labor and overheads we will divide 4,416 by 3,680, because it is only complete up to 3,680 units or 60%. So the total cost per unit will now be 1.5 in respect of material, 1.2 in respect of labor. So the total cost will be 2.7 cost per unit. Now the next step, step number 3, equivalent units. Completed production is how much? 3,200. And what cost we have calculated for?
2.7.
So the total cost will be 8,640. How much material is completed? 100%. Material is also 100% complete. What was the cost of material? So the cost of total material will be, but labor and overheads, how much they are complete? 60%. It means 480 units we will consider equivalent units to be complete at a price of. So the total cost of input will be 10,416. The total cost in the process account. So now how will we identify how much was the input? Material 4,000 at a price of 6,000, labor at a price of 4,416. So the total side, debit side of the process account will be 10,416. How much were the finished goods? 3,200. And what cost we have calculated?
1.5.
No, 8,640. Total cost. Total cost of finished goods.
Yes.
8,640. And what is the cost we have calculated for incomplete units? The closing WIP in respect of material and labor, 1776. Add them, your accounts will be balanced. Okay, I know this part is a bit more technical, so that will be coming with the help of more and more practice definitely. And this ends up your second last chapter, that was the chapter of job, batch and process costing. Three costing techniques we have discussed. So just a quick review, in job costing, what are the features of job costing? Special requirement of the customer. Only one identifiable job is there, and all the cost which is being incurred in the job will be added, and we will be identifying one cost of the job. If it is a markup, what we will keep 100%?
Cost.
If it is a margin, what we will keep 100%? Sales. Okay, then comes the next, batch costing. Any difference in batch and job costing? Only the difference of more than one units which are identical and same in nature to each other, right? So units will be same and identical in nature to each other, and they will be calculated as a cost of whole batch, and then in the end we will be calculating cost per unit of the batch by dividing the total cost of the batch by total number of units in one batch. Then comes the process costing. What are the features of process costing? Continuous processes are there. The output of one process becomes the input of the other process. We have homogeneous products. Homogeneous means incomplete, right? Homogeneous products. And in process costing, what was the main thing to learn? The T account of process. What is the concept of equivalent units? If 100 units are there, each unit is 30% complete. So we will assume that out of 100, 30 units are complete. Okay. So these are the three costing techniques that we have discussed, and we have done a good amount of examples as well on these questions. Now we will be moving on towards the questions, but you guys can take a break and then we will be discussing about the questions. Okay. Thank you very much, guys.